السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. All thanks and praise are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and may His peace and blessings be upon His last and final messenger, His family, His companions, and those who follow them until the end of times. So alhamdulillah, last week we were able to explore the meanings and lessons of verses 65 through 72. And inshallah tonight we will complete the surah. So we will cover from verses 73 till 77, which will bring us to the end of this beautiful and noble surah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept this effort of ours, to place it on our scale of good deeds on the Day of Judgment, and to make it a means of light for us in the hereafter. So for the past 2 weeks, we've been discussing the last passage of Surah Al-Furqan that deals with a very beautiful, a very eloquent and comprehensive description of Ibadur Rahman, of the servants of the Most Merciful. And as we've discussed, this passage highlights their distinctive features as reflected in their behavior and the manner in which they conduct their lives. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is highlighting these very specific qualities, attributes, characteristics that the servants of the Most Merciful exemplify in their daily lives and in their behavior. So these are the individuals that we're supposed to aspire to become. These are our role models. And all of us, alhamdulillah, have the ability to be from amongst them. Meaning to become amongst the ibad al-Rahman, this is an actual achievable goal. It's something that all of us can reach. So in this passage, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He describes them with 11 unique qualities and characteristics. And so far we've been able to discuss 9 of them. So far we have discussed first and foremost the concept of humility, at-tawadu'. The second is al-hilm, forbearance. The third is the fact that they spent the night in prayer. They pray salatul tahajjud. The fourth is khawf, fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fifth was being balanced and moderate. They were not wasteful, especially when it came to spending their wealth. The sixth is that they were free from shirk. They did not associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't worship any individual, statue, idol, or ideology along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The seventh is that they stay away from major sins such as murder and zina. The eighth is repentance, that whenever they happen to make a mistake, they always go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and seek His forgiveness. And the ninth is forgiveness itself, that they always constantly seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for any of their shortcomings, for any of their mistakes or faults. Now the next quality that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions is that these individuals are always willing to accept reminders from others. And this is a sign of their humility. So it's actually an extension of their humility, that when people remind them, when people advise them, they have open hearts and open minds. They're willing to take other people's advice. So this is a sign again of their humility, their God consciousness, and their willingness to do good and improve their own behavior. So their hearts and minds are receptive to advice, corrections, admonitions, and reminders. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِّرُوا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ لَمْ يَخِرُّوا عَلَيْهَا سُمَّا وَعُمْيَانًا. And who, when they are reminded of the signs of their Lord, وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِّرُوا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ, that these are the individuals when they are reminded of the signs or the verses of their Lord, لَمْ يَخِرُّوا عَلَيْهَا سُمَّا وَعُمْيَانًا, they don't fall upon them deaf and blind, or fall not deaf and blind against them. So this is a very, very unique quality that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing to us. They say it is a sign of a soft heart and humility. And one of the things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam emphasized to us is bringing humility into our lives and making our hearts soft. So oftentimes books of hadith, right, collections of hadith, are going to have this entire chapter called Kitab al-Raqa'iq. And most of the translators, they translate it as the book of heart softeners. So these are ahadith that talk about, you know, things that might take place in the future or some realities that cause our hearts to become soft. And this is a very important quality for us to have as believers. So these individuals, they don't think that they're better than anyone else because of their knowledge or good deeds. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already described them as God-conscious, upright individuals. They are people of taqwa, they're people of humility, they pray tahajjud at night. But none of these things gets to their head, right? None of these things makes them think that they're better than others. So they don't feel like they're better than others because of their knowledge or good deeds. They don't have that air of arrogance and pride. So they have open hearts and minds, always willing to accept the truth and advice. And unfortunately, one of the destructive sins that afflicts practicing upright individuals is pride and arrogance. And a lot of our teachers and scholars will say this is the most destructive sin for people who are trying to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because of the fact that they're increasing in knowledge, and because of the fact that they're increasing in practice and a'mal, sometimes shaitan comes to them and says, you are better than so and so. That you pray at night and he doesn't, or she doesn't pray at night. Or you know more Qur'an than that individual. Or you know this and you do that. So shaitan starts whispering into their hearts and it creates this level of arrogance. So thinking that they're better than others either because of their knowledge or because of their involvement at the masjid or because of their generosity. Or perhaps they're not arrogant, perhaps they don't have pride, but they look down upon others and belittle them. So the servants of the most merciful ibad al-Rahman, they are not like that. When they are reminded of Allah's signs, they pay full attention to them, listening carefully with attentive ears and open hearts and minds. So وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِّرُوا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ لَمْ يَخِرُّوا عَلَيْهَا صُمَّا وَعُمْيَانًا. They don't fall deaf and blind upon them. So what the commentators say this means is that they do not ignore them. When someone is telling them about the signs, the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they don't turn the opposite way. They don't ignore. Rather, they pay attention. And this is not referring to physical deafness and blindness. Rather, it is referring to spiritual deafness and blindness. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَمْ يَخِرُّوا عَلَيْهَا سُمَّا وَعُمْيَانًا, He's not talking about a physical impairment. It's not being physically blind or deaf, but it's talking about being spiritually blind and spiritually deaf. Meaning they're too proud and arrogant to listen to people reminding them of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this concept of spiritual blindness and deafness, it's mentioned several places throughout the Qur'an. And oftentimes it is related to arrogance and pride. And the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala affect them. So they're affected and moved by the words that they hear. And this is especially true with the actual words, the actual verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the word ayat in Arabic, it's the plural of the word ayah. And linguistically, it just means a sign. Any sign that indicates towards the existence or the might or power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the word ayah in ayat also has a very specific meaning. It's referring to the verses of the Qur'an, the actual words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is a unique quality of ibad al-Rahman as well. That when someone reminds them of the Qur'an, when someone recites the Qur'an to them, or they're reciting the Qur'an themselves, it has some sort of effect upon them. It causes their heart to be affected and to move. It causes some sort of emotions within them. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes to us in Suratul Anfal, when He's describing the believers to us, that إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ, that the believers are only those who, when Allah is mentioned, their hearts become fearful. So just the mention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the word Allah, it has an effect upon them. Something happens inside of them, these emotions start to stir, their hearts become affected. وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. And when His verses are recited unto them, it increases them in faith. So whenever they hear the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it increases their iman. It brings them closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It strengthens their faith. وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. And they rely solely upon their Lord. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says something similar in Surah At-Tawbah. That وَإِذَا مَا أُنزِلَتْ سُورَةً فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَقُولُ أَيُّكُمْ زَادَتْهُ هَذِهِ إِيمَانًا فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فَزَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَهُمْ يَسْتَبْشِرُونَ. And whenever a surah, whenever a verse is revealed, there are amongst the hypocrites who say, which of you has this increased in faith? So the hypocrites would have this attitude of arrogance and pride, but the believers would be the opposite. As for those who believed, it has increased them in faith, while they are rejoicing. So وَإِذَا ذُكِّرُوا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ, when they're reminded of Allah's word, something happens to them. Their iman becomes stronger, their iman becomes, they get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, Allah has sent down the best discourse, a book containing subjects resembling each other, mentioned again and again, shivered from which are the skins of those who have awe of their Lord. So meaning the people who actually fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the Qur'an is recited to them, they get goosebumps, right? Something happens to them where they actually have an emotional connection with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then their skins and their hearts become soft enough to tend to the remembrance of Allah. Right? ثُمَّ تَنِينُ جُلُودُهُمْ وَقُلُوبُهُمْ. And that's the point. Their hearts become soft once again. And once their hearts become soft, they become receptive of the reminders and remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the guidance of Allah with which He brings to the right path whomsoever He wills. And as for the one whom Allah lets go astray, for him there is no one to guide. So again, Allah in this verse is highlighting to us this very unique quality of having a soft, receptive heart. And this is something that is very difficult to develop. It's something very difficult to nurture. Because oftentimes as human beings, we have this self-pride, that oftentimes we think we are above reproach, we are above correction, we're above receiving advice from others. But that is not the quality of someone with humility. That's not the quality of Ibadur Rahman. When someone approaches them in a gentle manner and someone tries to correct them and remind them, they are listening and they're willing to accept it and change. Alright, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the last quality, the last characteristic mentioned, which is supplicating and turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They call it al-iqbalu ala Allah, that they actually turn in supplication to their Lord and Creator. And for a specific purpose, for having a spouse and children that will follow in their footsteps of faith and righteousness. So they're not only concerned about themselves, they're not only concerned about their own personal salvation, but they're also concerned about the salvation of their spouse and children. That they do not want to be alone. They want to spread their benefit. They want to spread goodness in this world. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ وَاجْعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. And those who say, our Lord, grant us spouses and offspring who will be the coolness of our eyes and cause us to be the foremost amongst the God conscious. So وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ, those who say, رَبَّنَا, O our Lord, هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ, that grant us spouses and offsprings that will be the coolness of our eyes. وَجَعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا, and make us the foremost amongst the God conscious. So the commentators say this is another sign of their deeply rooted faith, that they turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asking Him to bless them with righteous wives and upright children who are upon guidance and perform righteous deeds as well. That they want their family to be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They want their family to be people of faith and iman and righteousness. And they want them to be the coolness of their eyes. قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ. So this is an Arabic expression. The literal translation would be coolness of one's eyes. But it's referring more to peace and happiness, joy, contentment. So it's an Arabic expression used to convey the meanings of comfort, happiness, and joy. That their spouses, their children, are a source of joy and comfort and happiness and contentment for them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that this true joy and comfort, contentment, it comes from the fact that our family is close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't come from any material things. It doesn't come from accolades. It doesn't come from looks or possessions. All of it comes through their faith and through their iman. So they say this is a very, very profound concept that is being highlighted in this verse. That one of our greatest sources of joy and happiness in the life of this world is family. And all of us experience that. That the thing that makes us the most happy, the thing that brings us the most joy, is supposed to be our spouses and our children. That when we have this healthy, you know, united family that's together, that strong, it's a strong unit, and makes life enjoyable. And that's one of the goals that we're constantly working towards. That's one of the objectives that we have in life. So for us as men specifically, when we are searching for a spouse, a suitable partner for life, we look for many, many different qualities, traits, and characteristics. And the same thing goes for the sisters. That when they're searching for a husband, they're looking for multiple number of things. They're looking for multiple qualities and traits and characteristics. So choosing a partner for life is one of the most important decisions a person makes in life. And that's why we're taught not to take this lightly. Right, it's not supposed to be something that, you know, you just wake up and do one day. It's something that requires thought, it requires effort, it requires time and energy. So when searching for a spouse, a person is supposed to make a careful, serious, well thought out, and most importantly, mature decision. It's not supposed to be based solely off of emotions. And that is a very important point. Because emotions, obviously, between the opposite genders run high. But when we are going for marriage, the decision should not solely be based off of emotion. So both individuals should share common interests, goals, aspirations, and outlooks on life. And the absolute best qualities to look for in a spouse are those mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us that تُنْكَحُ الْمَرْأَةُ لِأَرْبَعٍ, that a woman usually is married for four reasons. And he mentions that for her wealth, her lineage, her beauty, and her religious inclination. And then he says, choose the one who is religious or you will be ruined. So the Prophet ﷺ is speaking to his companions. And he's telling them that in society, the most prevalent reasons for getting married are either a woman's beauty, her wealth, or lineage. And the fourth is religion. Their religious inclination, their connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet ﷺ says, فَظْفُرْ بِذَاتِ الدِّينِ, seek success, seek victory with the spouse who has religion, who is connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you don't, you will be ruined. It's going to lead towards problems. Right? In another narration, the Prophet ﷺ said, if one whose religion and good character pleases you, request you for marriage, then accept his request, otherwise there will be great trial, fitna, and widespread destruction. So this hadith is being addressed to the sahabiyah, to the female companions, and to their guardians, that if an appropriate, suitable male whose religion and good character pleases you, requests you for marriage, then accept his request. That this is the most important thing to give consideration to, their character and their deen. And I know oftentimes, especially in today's society, we see the exact opposite. That the last thing that we look for is a person's religion, is a person's character. And the first thing we look for is what? Money. How much money does this individual make? I want to see his bank statement, I want to see his pay stub. Right? Things like that actually happen. Or they say that, you know, he has to come from like this excellent family, he has to be highly educated. And these are the things that we give the absolute most importance to. And then religion and practicing and being close to Allah, it's a secondary thought. It's something that if it's there, alhamdulillah, if it's not, no problem. But the Prophet ﷺ is telling us, no, the most important thing is the individual's character and the individual's faith, their connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So based on these narrations and several others, the most important qualities to be considered are a person's commitment to religion, righteousness, morality, and good manners. So for those of us who have daughters, this is extremely important. That if someone comes to us, then they approach us for the hand in marriage, and this is a righteous, pious, God-conscious, practicing individual, and they are a person of good character, we've checked them out, and you know our daughters are willing to marry this person, we should let it happen. This is what the Prophet ﷺ is encouraging us to do. And not doing so will lead to many issues, it will lead to many problems. And a lot of these problems are seen in society today. Where oftentimes, you know, unfortunately people keep delaying, keep delaying, keep delaying, and sometimes people don't end up getting married. Or they keep delaying and keep delaying, keep delaying, and then they don't get married to the person that they wanted to get married to. So it creates a lot of issues, and the Prophet ﷺ himself is saying that it's going to lead to fitna. There will be great trial and widespread destruction. So this is a very important concept to keep in mind. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is highlighting here. That these people say, رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ. So the most important thing is for our spouse to be God-conscious, pious, moral, upright, and practicing. And the same thing goes for our children. That we want our children to be God-conscious, upright, morally, ethical individuals. And of course, we want what's best for them in this life of this world as well. And usually that's our primary concern. When we have children, our primary concern is keeping them safe and protected, making sure they're getting an excellent education, making sure they get an excellent career and they're financially stable. And we're always looking at things in this world. We have concern for them in this world. But our primary concern should be for their akhirah. If we want true success for our children, then that true success doesn't come in the life of this world. It comes in the life of the hereafter. And that's why we see this imbalance within families, where there is way too much emphasis on academics. That there's so much emphasis on academics that the entire life of the child revolves around studying and school and classes and practice and this and that, trying to get to these Ivy League schools and med school, etc. And then when you look at the religious inclinations of the child, nothing's there, right? Perhaps they don't come to the masjid, they don't know how to even read Quran. There's a lot of issues. And we've seen this, there's been a lot of cases where, you know, the entire life, the parents, they have care and concern for their children, but they focus on their academics. And once they reach 18, 19, 20, they're in college, now their children are struggling with faith. They're struggling with Iman and struggling with being Muslim in their identity. And then they come to the Imam and say, fix our child, or speak to our child. Right? By the time they're 19 and 20 and they're struggling with their faith, it's already too late. They've made up their mind, they've made up their choice. That concern, that care should have been there from the time they were born. That how can we keep our children upon faith? How can we keep them upon Iman? How can we raise them as God-conscious, moral individuals? And that is a huge responsibility on our shoulder as parents. كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ. Each of you is a shepherd. وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَّتِي. And each of you is responsible for their flock. So as parents, as fathers, as mothers, we are responsible for our children. And we are going to be asked about how we raised our children. And the absolute most important thing that we should be concerned about is their faith. It is their Iman. Obviously, again, the worldly aspect is important. There's this balance. We give importance to that. But if our child doesn't become a doctor, right? God forbid for the Desi parents, right? If our child doesn't become a doctor, but they are people of good character, and they're God-conscious, and they're practicing, that is a sign of success. That's something we should take pride in, right? But if our child becomes, I don't know, like the best doctor in the world, but they have no faith, they have no generosity and no kindness in their heart, they're not people of good character, then that should be a source of sadness for us. And you're going to see the effects of that in your life later on as well. So we want our children to be God-conscious as well. And that is one of our main focuses as well. So our main focus should be nurturing them to be upright and God-conscious, well-mannered individuals. So individuals will make us proud, not just for their worldly accomplishments, but that will make us proud in this world and the next. And that is what will bring us true comfort, true joy, happiness, and contentment. That's how they become qurratu a'yun, right? That's how our spouses and children will become the coolness of our eyes. That when we see them as these individuals whose faith is strong and they're closer to Allah, and they remind us about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they bring us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's what's going to make us have this contentment and joy in our lives. And then in addition to asking for righteous spouses and pious children, they also ask, وَجَعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. And cause us to be the foremost amongst the God-conscious. So the literal translation of this verse is, and make us leaders for the God-conscious. Right? The word imam, it usually means leader. So make us leaders for the people of God-consciousness. So these individuals, they want to be a good example for others who are God-conscious to follow as well. And again, that's the nature that we're supposed to have as believers. We do not want just what's good for us, but we want good for everyone around us. Right? That is how we are supposed to be with each other. Whatever we want for ourselves, we want for others. As the Prophet ﷺ told us, that none of you truly believes until you love for your brother what you love for yourself. So just as these individuals want to be close to Allah, they also want their friends and family and co-workers and neighbors to be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. So one of the commentators, they wrote, this is a natural feeling based on a profound sense of faith. Right? Them wanting to be good examples and role models
is a natural feeling based on a profound sense of faith. It expresses a strong desire to increase the number of people who follow divine guidance, and that the first in such increased numbers should be their own offspring and spouses, who are the closest to them. Indeed, these are a man's first responsibility. And added to this natural feeling is the believer's hope that they will provide examples of goodness to be followed by those who are keen to earn Allah's pleasure. And there is no element of selfishness or arrogance in such a wish, because all the God-conscious are on the way that God defines. So basically, this is a natural consequence of Iman, that we want people to be with us. We want people to be people of faith as well. And Ibn Kathir rahimullah, he writes, they want their worship to be connected to the worship of their children and offspring. And they want their guidance to go beyond themselves and benefit others. And this would be more rewarding and a better end. As it was recorded that Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu said, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا مَاتَ ابْنُ آدَمْ إِنْقَطَعَ عَمَلُهُ, that when the son of Adam passes away, his actions decease. His actions desist, they stop. Right? إِنْقَطَعَ عَمَلُهُ, there's no more deeds. إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ, except for three things. وَلَدٍ صَالِحٍ يَدْعُو لَهُ, that this individual raised a righteous child. And this righteous child continues to make dua for this individual. أَوْ عِلْمٍ يُنْتَفَعُ بِي مِنْ بَعْدِ, or he left behind some knowledge that was a cause of benefit after his death. أَوْ صَدَقَةٍ جَارِيَةٍ, or this continuous charity, that he left behind some charity that's going to continuously benefit individuals, like establishing a masjid, or like, donating books to library, whatever it may be. So these are the three things that will benefit us even after we leave this world. And the point for mentioning this hadith is, وَلَدٍ صَالِحٍ يَدْعُو لَهُ, that he left behind a righteous, pious child that makes dua for him. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he, after mentioning all of these qualities and characteristics and traits of Ibadur Rahman, he ends the passage by mentioning their reward. That what is the reward for people who have these 11 qualities? What is the reward for Ibadur Rahman? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, أُولَٰئِكَ يُجْزَوْنَ الْغُرْفَ بِمَا صَبَرُوا, it is they who will be rewarded with the lofty abode for having been patient. وَيُلَقَّوْنَ فِيهَا تَحِيَّةً وَسَلَامًا, and they will be met therein with salutations and greetings of peace. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا حَسُنَتْ مُسْتَقَرًّا وَمُقَامًا, abiding therein forever, and what a beautiful dwelling place and station. So basically Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that these individuals are guaranteed paradise. That whoever has these 11 traits and 11 qualities, whoever is amongst Ibadur Rahman, they are guaranteed paradise. أُولَٰئِكَ يُجْزَوْنَ الْغُرْفَةَ بِمَا صَبَرُوا, they will be given the recompense of الْغُرْفَةَ. So الْغُرْفَةَ, it means room, but all the commentators say it's talking about paradise. They will be given paradise بِمَا صَبَرُوا, because of their patience, because of their perseverance, because they remain steadfast in the life of this world. So these individuals that have just been described with these attributes and qualities will be rewarded in the hereafter with al-ghurfa, which is translated as the lofty abode. And the lofty abode al-ghurfa, it literally means the uppermost part of a dwelling. And here it refers to a dwelling in paradise. They will be given this dwelling, this house, this residence in paradise. And it's referring to heaven or a special place in heaven. So some commentators mention as generals, just referring to Jannah. And others mention, no, it's referring to a specific part, a specific portion of Jannah. And they will receive this special place in heaven because of what they endured with patience in the life of this world. Bima sabr. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us the underlying reason why they get this paradise. It is because of their sabr. It is because of their patience. So this is a very unique perspective that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is providing us with. He's telling us that the basis and foundation of all the qualities that have been mentioned is sabr. So all 11 things that we covered, whether it's humility, whether it's hilm, forbearance, whether it's tahajjud, whether it's making tawbah and dua and istighfar, whether it's being balanced and moderate, all of these attributes and qualities require patience. So it requires a lot of willpower, self-restraint, control, patience, and perseverance to be amongst ibadur rahman. And that's why the scholars mention that patience is perhaps the greatest virtue that we have in Islam. The absolute greatest virtue that we have within our faith and religion is sabr. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ told us that the reward for patience is paradise. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elsewhere in the Quran, He says, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ, that the patient will be given their reward without any accounting. Right? There's no accounting when it comes to patience. They will just be given reward, unimaginable reward. So some scholars mention that sabr is one of the most important qualities mentioned in the Quran. And sabr, it's one of those words in Arabic whose essence or reality can't be captured in a single word in English. So usually when we hear the word sabr, it's translated as patience. So linguistically speaking, it's a verbal noun from the verb sabara yasbiru in Arabic. And this verb, it conveys several different meanings. So it can mean to bind, right? It can mean to tie something together, right? Sabara can mean to bind or tie something. It can mean to be patient, forbearing, to endure, to persevere, to abstain, and also to refrain. So the grammarians, they mention it comes from the root letters sad, ba, and ra. And these convey the meaning of refraining or abstaining. So the actual linguistic meaning of sabr is to restrain, right? It means to withhold, to refrain, to abstain. So when a person is patient, they are holding back certain emotions, desires, impulses, speech, and behavior. And that is like the essence, that's the core of patience. Right? When a person has sabr, when a person has patience, they're holding back certain emotions. And that's why controlling anger is a part of patience. Controlling our sorrow and sadness is a part of patience. Right? Even controlling our happiness and joy, it's a part of patience. Because we're holding back emotions, desires. Staying away from sin is an aspect of patience. Right? Being able to control our eyes and our tongue is an aspect of patience. Our impulses, our speech and behavior. So as a virtue or character trait, sabr has been defined in a number of different ways. So basically, if you look throughout like Islamic literature, we're going to find that scholars describe this concept in several different ways. So for example, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimullah, he defined it as حَبْسُ النَّفْسِ عَنْ مَحَارِمِ اللَّهِ وَحَبْسُهَا عَلَى فَرَائِدِ وَحَبْسُهَا عَنِ التَّسَخُّطِ وَالشِّكَايَةِ لِأَقْدَارِ, that restraining the soul from the prohibitions of Allah. That one aspect of patience is withholding and holding yourself back from falling into sin, from falling into the prohibitions, restraining it upon his obligations. That part of patience is performing and adhering to all the obligations that Allah has given us, and restraining the soul from being angry or complaining about his decree. Right? And that's how the scholars say that there's actually three types of patience. They say there's a sabru ala ta'at. There's patience among acts of obedience. So it takes a level of self-restraint, it takes a level of discipline to pray five times a day. It takes a level of self-restraint and discipline to fast the month of Ramadan. And that's all a part of patience. Then they say, as-sabru anil ma'asi. Part of patience, and this is the second type, is staying away from sin. It takes self-restraint, it takes control to stay away from following our desires. And the third is, as-sabru ala aqdarillah. Being patient with the decree of Allah. And that means accepting the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever it may be. Right? Another scholar, he defined it as هُوَ تَرْكُ الشَّكْوَى مِنْ أَلَمِ الْبَلْوَى لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا إِلَى اللَّهِ, that not complaining about the pain of trials to other than Allah, not to Allah. So he's saying patience means that you don't complain about what's going on to you to other individuals. Right? Patience means you don't complain about difficulties and hardships to other human beings. But you do tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about it. And what that means is you make dua to Allah to remove those hardships and difficulties from our lives. Right? Another scholar described it as هُوَ الثَّبَاتُ عَلَى أَحْكَامِ الْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ, that patience is remaining firm and steadfast upon the rulings of the Qur'an and Sunnah. Others mentions هُوَ الْوُقُوفُ مَعَ الْبَلَاءِ بِحُسْنِ الْأَدَبِ, it is to face trials and difficulties and hardships with the best of character. So again, all of these descriptions and definitions and explanations, they're trying to capture the reality of sabr. And the one thing they share in common is this concept of self-restraint or holding ourselves back. And that is like the crux of sabr. Self-restraint, discipline, and holding ourselves back. And that's why it's been described as remaining firm or steadfast upon that which the soul regards as difficult. And they say this is actually a very comprehensive description of patience. To remain firm and steadfast upon that which our souls consider to be difficult. And that's why the reward of patience is so great. That's why the reward of patience is paradise. So there you go. أُولَٰئِكَ يُجْزَوْنَ الْغُرْفَ بِمَا صَبَرُوا. They will be given this special place in paradise because of their patience. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us all amongst the patient, inshaAllah. Alright. وَيُلَقَّوْنَ فِيهَا تَحِيَّةً وَسَلَامًا. And they will be met therein with salutations and greetings of peace. Meaning once they enter paradise, the malaika are going to greet them with peace and salam. Alright, some of the commentators mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will greet them with peace and salam. And the reason for mentioning that is because the world is not the world of peace. This is a world of trial and tribulation and hardship and difficulty. The akhirah, the hereafter, is the world and life of absolute peace and tranquility and security. So يُلَقَّوْنَ فِيهَا تَحِيَّةً وَسَلَامًا. Greetings and peace will be given to them in the hereafter. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. And they will be there for all of eternity. They'll be in paradise for all of eternity. حَسُنَتْ مُسْتَقَرًّا وَمُقَامًا. What a beautiful dwelling place and station. Right, what a beautiful place to be. What a beautiful place to be. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us all from the people of Jannah. Alright, Allah ends this surah by reminding us about our true purpose in life. And we can say this is perhaps the central theme of the entire surah. That our true purpose in life is ibadah. Our true purpose in life is to worship Allah and to be amongst the servants, to be amongst ibadur rahman. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ مَا يَعْبَأُ بِكُمْ رَبِّي لَوْلَا دُعَاءُكُمْ فَقَدْ كَذَّبْتُمْ فَسَوْفَ يَكُونُ لِزَامًا. Say, what weight would my Lord give you were it not for your supplication? Right? What weight, what importance, what significance would my Lord give to you if it were not for your dua? And most of the commentators mention the word dua here, it means ibadah, it means worship. And the Prophet ﷺ told us, الدُعَى مُخُّ الْعِبَادَةِ. That dua, supplication, is the essence of worship. So essentially, dua is another name for ibadah. It's an act of worship. So, قُلْ مَا يَعْبَأُ بِكُمْ رَبِّي لَوْلَا دُعَاءُكُمْ. That your Lord would not give you any importance, any significance, any value, if it were not for your worship. فَقَدْ كَذَّبْتُمْ فَسَوْفَ يَكُونُ لِزَامًا. But you have denied, and it will be inevitable. And this last part is speaking to the non-believers of Quraysh, or any non-believers that come after them. فَقَدْ كَذَّبْتُمْ. But you have denied, you have rejected, you have refused. فَسَوْفَ يَكُونُ لِزَامًا. So punishment will be inevitable. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, no weight or value would my Lord attach to you were it not for your calling out to Him. So they say the first part of the question is an idiom that indicates that one considers another of no consequence or importance. So the question would mean, of what consequence or importance would you be were it not for your worship? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Ghani. Right? Al-Ghani, the translation they give in English is the independent. But what that means is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from any need. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in no need of human beings. He has no need for our worship, He has no need for our belief. Right? It does not affect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in any way if we believe or disbelieve. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Ghani. Rather, it is we as human beings who are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why there's that famous hadith Qudsi, that if all of mankind and jinn were to believe, it wouldn't affect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in any way, shape or form. And if all of mankind were to disbelieve and be like amongst the worst of people, it wouldn't affect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in any way, shape or form. Because He is Al-Ghani. But we as human beings, we get value from worship. We get value from being close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So commentators understand this verse to mean that a human being's purpose in life is to worship Allah. So قُلْ مَا يَعْبَأُ بِكُمْ رَبِّي لَوْلَا دُعَاءُكُمْ. The only thing that gives human beings value and worth and importance and significance is the fact that they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If they're not worshipping Allah, They have no value, no significance, no importance. And this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us elsewhere. That وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ That I have created man and jinn only to worship me. So that is what gives human beings value when they live life according to this purpose. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends the surah by addressing those who consciously choose to reject the truth. فَقَدْ كَذَّبْتُمْ But you have denied. فَسَوْفَ يَكُونُ رِزَامًا And it will be inevitable. Meaning you have denied and rejected the truth and refused to believe in Allah and the message of His Prophet. And as a result of that rejection and disbelief, punishment in the hereafter will be inevitable. So the surah ends with a very powerful warning to the non-believers of Mecca. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very explicitly gives them this warning. فَقَدْ كَذَّبْتُمْ You have rejected, you have refused, you have disbelieved, you're not accepting the truth. Because of that, فَسَوْفَ يَكُونُ نِزَامًا You are going to face an inevitable punishment. And the commentators mentioned that part of the reason for mentioning this is to console and comfort the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That you have done your job, you have conveyed the message, you have told them about the truth in the clearest terms possible, and now the ball is in their court. If they choose to accept it, they'll be given value and importance and significance. But if not, they're going to face punishment. And that is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends Suratul Furqan. So, alhamdulillah, we've gone through this surah over a journey of 14 sessions. Alhamdulillah. So we completed the surah in a journey of 14 sessions. And obviously the surah contained a discourse regarding several different subjects. But the absolute central, most important subject and theme of the surah is ibadah. It is worship. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ended the surah with this beautiful passage describing to us who ibadur rahman truly are. And as we've spoken about before, the purpose of reading the Qur'an and reciting the Qur'an and listening to the Qur'an is not simply information. It's not something that we just do. Rather, our intention to be to read it, to understand it, most importantly, to act upon it. And these 11 qualities, these 11 characteristics, are things that each of us has the ability to bring into our lives. We all have the opportunity to be amongst ibadur rahman. And again, this is something we can all do, but it does require effort. It requires energy. It requires time. It requires dedication. It requires discipline. And most importantly, it requires sabr. It requires patience. But if we are patient, if we're steadfast and we're firm, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is guaranteeing paradise to us. That if we have these 11 qualities, أُولَٰئِكَ يُجْزَوْنَ الْغُرْفَةَ بِمَا صَبَرُوا That these individuals will be given al-ghurfa, they will be given paradise because of their patience. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make all of us amongst the individuals who have been described in this verse. Right, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those people of humility. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst the people of hilm and forbearance. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the tawfiq, the ability to stand up in the middle of the night and pray and perform salatul tahajjud. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who are balanced and moderate. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who do not commit shirk, who stay away from major sins. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who constantly do tawbah and turn back to Him in repentance and seek His forgiveness and constantly supplicate to Him and to make us true servants of the Most Merciful so that we receive His mercy in this life and in the next. All right, any questions from this? Or these verses. Go ahead.
In the last lines of this surah,
mm-hmm.
you said that God has created human beings for worshipping.
Mm-hmm.
First, my question is twofold. Number one, angels were not sufficient enough to worship him, you know, so that he is a human being. Number two, he provided so many attractions and so difficulties and hardship in the life of a human being
yeah.
that he has to commit sins.
Yeah. So the thing is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, He doesn't need our worship. Right? He doesn't need our worship. They say it's His mercy that He created mankind. Right? It's out of His mercy that He brought us into this world. But after bringing us into this world, He's putting us to trial and tribulation and test. So all those distractions and sins and things that seem like attractive, they're all part of that test. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us so many opportunities for tawbah and istighfar and forgiveness. That no matter what we do, we can always get what? forgive him. The forgiveness is always there.
We're about, you know, talking about, you know, making dua for our children. And it's sometimes you wonder, there's, you know, on one end of the spectrum, you have, you know, children who are, you know, the parents seem to do everything right, so to speak. I mean, within their capabilities. Yeah. Someone here used to frequent the masjid and be part of the community, and now not only has he left Islam, but he's an evangelical Christian. And then on the other hand, you have parents, you know, sometimes you hear about these stories of people whose parents are basically drug addicts, for lack of a better term, like, you know, maybe these former rap singers and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Forefront of doubt.
Yeah.
So, and then you have various shades. So, is there any way, like, is there a sort of general guidelines to sort of increase our chances, or is it just a roll of the dice?
I mean, part of it is that it is just a roll of a dice. And the thing is that as long as you're giving your best effort, you have fulfilled your responsibility. So, our job is to just make sure that we're teaching our children, nurturing them properly. And once they become adults, it's their decision. And that's why we have examples even from the stories of the prophets. Where we have Lut alayhi salam. He's a prophet of God, but his wife is amongst the worst of people. Or you have examples of Nuh alayhi salam, that his own son refused to join him on the ship. So that's part of it. I mean, I don't want to say it's like rolling the dice. But part of it is that you do what you think is best to nurture and bring up your child. And then you leave the rest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So a huge part of it is this aspect of tawakkul and constantly making dua for them. And I mean, all these things have an effect on our children. And I think the cases, these would be the exceptions to the rule. Right? Where it happens where like the parents do everything that's right and it turns out that the kid is just like whatever. That would be an exception to the rule. The general is always going to be that if you put in the effort, it's going to be righteous. But those exceptions are highlighted to as teaching lessons that this also happens and it's not your necessarily your fault. But again, our thing is at least we should have that concern, that caring concern.
No. I have a follow-up question.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, you know, it's also, you know, we as Muslims need to be very careful with the words we choose. You know, sometimes you would hear stuff like if you would hear somebody who's, you know, whose child has left Islam, some people just like to get, you know, get something inside of them. They just like to put it into them.
Mm-hmm.
Like to say, oh, brother, it's because of your sins.
Yeah.
You know. Well, then I go back to the other example. Well, what about Nuh alayhi salam?
Exactly.
We say that he didn't have taqwa, and that's why his son.
Exactly.
And you can't judge people like that.
Yeah.
So, you know, we have to, you know, sometimes we have to be careful with our words and basically supportive of those,
Yeah, very careful with it. It's very difficult for the parents, for the family, and even the individual themselves. And that's why they say oftentimes when you come across a case like that, don't even try to proselytize at first. You give comfort, you give like reassurance to the family, and the individual you keep maintain relations with them, but don't necessarily engage with them in like a religious discussion. And oftentimes they say that why that happens is they had a negative experience with the community. It's not necessarily like an intellectual critique of Islam or like some intellectual reason. It's all, a lot of it's emotional. There's some trauma, there's something they experienced that just pushed them away so far. I mean, the best we can do is at least make dua that Allah gives them hidayah, brings them back, inshallah. Yeah.
I want to add something to his question. I believe it, you know, that the destiny is fixed regardless of how much you pray or whatever you do, you know. It will make twist slightly for the time being, but eventually you have to face whatever God has written in your destiny. That's it.
Not necessarily. Right, so as human beings, we have this concept of free will. Right, what that reality that free will is, that it's not really understood. Right, as human beings, we don't understand what that free will is. But what we do know is that we are the ones making these conscious decisions. So our job is to work and do the right thing. And usually if you work and do the right thing, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts you on that path of guidance. And there's this hadith where the Prophet ﷺ told us that, you know, there's going to be a person that they live their entire life in sin. Right? Their entire life they spent sinning. So much so that they're only like a hand span away from the fire of hell. Then all of a sudden at the end of their life they did what? Tawbah. Right? All of a sudden at the end of their life they did tawbah, they changed their lives and they become from the people of paradise. And they say that's from the rahmah and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That there are individuals in this world, and this happens a lot, where they are like the worst human beings, but on their deathbed they take the shahada. They haven't done one good thing in their life except for what? The shahada. And they still become people of paradise. And there's an example of the man who killed 99 then. He made it an even 100. He didn't do any good deed in his life except for accepting Islam and going towards the righteous place, and then he died. But because of that, he was amongst the people of paradise. But then you also have the opposite. You have people that they spend their entire life as righteous individuals, as good, pious human beings. So much so that they're this close to paradise. But then they do something what? They do something before they die that takes them to hellfire. But the commentators say that scenario is very rare. That is just an exception to the rule. That's very rare. Something, they said some, you know, maybe they were unjust to a person, they committed some crime, they said some words of disbelief, maybe they disbelieved at the end of life, something happened to them. And that's why we always make dua for husnul khatimah, to have a good ending. That we our last words should be la ilaha illallah, that we leave upon faith, we die upon faith. And that's a dua that we should all make. Right, that Allah takes us away upon iman. There was one thing that just slipped my mind. It was a very unique case, but it just slipped my mind. Inshallah. Now, all right. So we ask Allah to accept this from us and place our skill of good deeds under judgment. We're going to break for the month of Ramadan, and we will continue after Ramadan, inshallah. And we will just keep going in sequence. So the next surah is Surah Shu'ara, the poets. So we'll do that next, inshallah. So may Allah accept us from us and place our skill of good deeds on their judgment. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanakallah bihamdik, nashadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Jazakumullah khairan, wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.